Welcome back, everybody, to Flyover Fest. We are soon to start our next session with Erin Rollenhagen in about a minute or so, where she'll be talking about tech that's built to scale. But first, I want to remind everyone to please join our Facebook group, the Do More with Less Facebook group, where you can join us in a discussion where we're talking about changing the conversation. We're talking about sales automation, marketing automation, everything that we've talked about here today. Copywriting, conversational AI, you name it, we're talking about it there. And as a reminder, as an added bonus, and thank you for attendance, you'll be entered in a raffle to win one of five Visa gift cards for $50 if you join that group. Once again, facebook.com/groups/do more w less, do more with less group. With that, we will have Erin Rollenhagen, the CEO and the CEO of Entrepreneurial Technologies, join us, and we're going to be talking about tech that's built to scale. So, welcome, Erin. Really appreciate you coming on today.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. I'm super excited about this one because when we were prepping for this, I think I told you were basically just describing my day, and it was refreshing to hear, and just a new kind of. It kind of threw me off for a second because I think a lot of us, you know, founders, leaders, and just generally, we like to talk about the high level, kind of more fun, you know, big picture visionary stuff like marketing and copywriting and changing our logo, things like that. But when it comes down to it, none of it really matters. What matters is delivering value to your customers at scale, building a product that delivers value, building a company that delivers value. And you know, that comes with a grind. So I'm really excited to hear about everything that you've learned. Can you tell us a little bit first about yourself, about Entrepreneurial Technologies, what you're doing, where you kind of come from?
Yeah, I started my career as a programmer working on big government projects and actually ended up doing a side project for a local small business and just had the opportunity to appreciate what custom development can do for a small business. And just how gratifying it was to see technology get in there and make a big difference in the way they did business every day. Ended up, I was 27 years old, thought I knew everything, ended up starting my own custom development business. And since then, we've worked with all sorts of startups, established companies, helped them build products and scale them.
Awesome. Absolutely. I love the insight. Really excited to dive in. But one thing I've been asking all our speakers today, just kind of as a nice, easy intro, but what has been the best part about building your companies outside the Silicon Valley?
You know, I think it's two things. One is the access to people. You know, the Midwest is amazing because I have never tried to get in touch with someone who would not talk to me here. You know, I mean, if you want to have coffee with someone, if you want to have a Zoom call with someone, they're generally open to it. And I think that's a fantastic thing just about this area. The second thing, I love the tagline, do more with less. I think that's a very, very Midwest mentality. And when you're building a company here, you know, just the willingness of all of the team members to figure out how to get it done, even if we don't have, you know, all of the sexy resources we would love to have.
That's very true. I really appreciate the shout out on the tagline. I think we all kind of embody it and love the answer. So since we're talking about tech that's built to scale, what does scale actually mean to you? Just kind of starting off maybe with outside of technology itself, how do other functions of a business factor into building a technology, something like sales, marketing, et cetera? Just generally, what does to scale mean to you?
Yeah, so I think when I first started, I would have thought of to scale in terms of like hardware and performance and that kind of thing. And you know, I don't want to oversimplify, but I think in large part we have solved a lot of those problems over the last 10 years with cloud infrastructure and a lot of the things we can do. And so now what happens is that the operational business problems really get revealed when the hardware is no longer a problem. And you know, what we see a lot of times is the very first step is sales, getting people on board, you know, and do we have a plan to do that smoothly? You know, what does it take to get someone on board? Do we need a support team? Do we need people power to actually get someone onto the system? is it a self-onboard process? If it's a self-onboard process, I love looking at different apps onboarding processes, because the thing is, that's, I feel like that's the thing you're going to put the most effort into, right? That's where you care about user experience, or should care about user experience the absolute most, is that moment when you're trying to get someone onboarded to the system. Mm-hmm. You know, and so what does that look like? And have we put the things we need to in place to give that person a smooth experience, whether it's a self-onboard or not? And then, you know, the sales team, have we given them the support they need? So do they need to be able to do demos? Do they need to be able to give people, you know, some sort of a provisional access? What do they need to be effective with it? Mm-hmm. I'm curious what you guys do.
Yeah, I think that you talked a little bit about it in sales, and we're still a relatively small sales organization, but you always have to put the process in place to get people to a demo. We always start with a demo and then hopefully get them to sign up and then move on into an onboarding. One place that I think that we focus on the onboarding, and you mentioned to it how important it is trying to get them to the aha moment. If you've heard of kind of that phrase, I think the Facebook, you know, Facebook might've coined parts of it, I'm sure, with other companies, but their aha moment they found in combing through data was people who add 7 friends in 7 days are likely to stay on the platform and find value in the platform. I think that we think about that a lot. Our product works by talking to leads, talking to prospects, and we've found our aha moment is a certain amount of leads that are processed by our product. And then kind of one step further, the really mind-blowing moment is when we first set an appointment or have a really good conversation with a lead. That's what we're selling. That is the value that we're selling. Doesn't matter if it's conversational AI technology built on cloud infrastructure. It doesn't matter. None of that matters. It's we delivered the value we promised, and they saw it. And that's something that we try and focus on quite a bit. And I think that everyone kind of needs to think about building towards before they actually really build the product.
Yeah, I love that. I love that.
So other than, kind of people ops, I guess, if you will, I think getting into the nitty gritty here a little bit, something else that other people might forget outside of onboarding is billing and infrastructure, the things that aren't so sexy, but you have to make money. Super important, and people, it has to be really easy for people to pay you and to collect and things like that. So when you're spinning up new products, features, or service, how do you think about building billing and other collections, accounting, functionality that make it easy for your people to actually scale around?
Yeah, so it's kind of appropriate where it's the first of the month, so it's billing day, I think, for a lot of products today.
Yes, it is.
If they have monthly cycles like that, so a good time to be talking about it. I think the first step is, again, start with that initial user experience. So how are you going to get money from that user the first time? How do you get them to pay the first time? And a lot of companies have gone to a free trial period. Well, there have been studies done that show that a free trial period with no credit card required ultimately nets about double the number of paid users as a free trial with a credit card required, right? But often that's not an easy pivot from a code standpoint if you haven't planned for it, because then you have to have some sort of mechanism to know when do you need to start collecting that information and how do you do it smoothly, because you certainly don't want to drop the ball at that point. So that's just kind of one little tip. You know, from a more global standpoint though, I think it makes sense to try to anticipate what are the ways we might try to bill in the future, not just today. And is there a way we can accommodate that? Most products have some sort of roadmap of this is our initial minimum viable product, and then this is what we think we're going to add in the future. And many of those adds might come with increased charges or upsells. What are you going to do about that? You know, is there a modular type billing system that you can put in place where people can sign up for things as they become available? Are you going to do packages? Are you going to do promo codes? You know, trying to build for those things, because the first thing you want to do once you get this fabulous new product out there is get a bunch of people to sign up and start billing them. So we really want to consider that as we're doing it. I think the final thing I would consider, and you know, Netflix really showed us a fantastic example of this, is people feel very committed to the price that they initially signed up for. And so if you want to try to raise prices later, and that's a common thing, a lot of startups underprice. They're, you know, they're trying to make the sales process easier. They don't want to hear a no based on price. So they underprice and then they have to go back later and fix it. Mm-hmm. And people don't, they feel cheated if you try to raise the price on them. So oftentimes you want to be able to sort of grandfather in the original users at the price they were used to, and then wait for them to want a feature add. And at that point you can reprice them accordingly. But your system obviously has to be able to support that and to understand, you know, these guys signed up at this pricing model, these guys signed up at this pricing model.
Absolutely. I can tell you firsthand, we are doing that literally today. we are going through some rebranding, some new offerings, kind of restructuring some of our pricing. Ultimately, it means lower cost per unit economics for our customers, but the prices are slightly higher in some regard. Because we've added a ton of new features, a whole bunch of new value are packed into those products. And we had to rip a lot of code out, put a lot new in. And thankfully, it wasn't too bad. They're very similar to our old plans. But I definitely hear where you're coming from. And I think one thing that I just personally took away from that is I love the no credit card trial approach. Right now, we've always required a credit card on our trials. And I can tell you that would be hard to rip out from a code perspective. That would be really challenging. Although I'm tempted to want to do that right now. definitely. So kind of switching gears from the ops perspective a little bit. When you're kind of thinking about product management, who you're selling to, et cetera, enterprise companies especially require like really granular user access and configs, configuration and controls. Just simply, you know, how do you get that right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think most programmers know that you want to minimize the amount of stuff that you're hard coding, right? But it's also very tempting when you know what the use case is to start to go ahead and hard code that, right? Because there's work involved in figuring out what's the structure, who can determine what, are we doing role-based? Are we doing group-based? How are we doing this? The larger the organization, the more control they are going to want to exercise over that. They may want you to come up with an SSO solution, you know, not overly difficult to do, but something that's got to be planned for. You know, they may want special pricing for their groups of users or to hide the pricing altogether. You know, they may want those granular user access controls. And so one thing that we found to be successful is to centralize that logic for user access in one place so that we can quickly make changes to it if we need to. Sometimes that means there's actually a UI for it and the administrator can go in and make changes. Even if not, as long as we create this centralized logic, we can at least easily make changes behind the scenes if we need to. So I think anticipating that from the get-go and going, you know, if my dream client, which is often a large enterprise client who's going to place a big order, you know, comes to me, what are the things that they would possibly be interested in changing about the product and tailoring it to their needs?
Yeah, that is, again, you're describing pretty much all of my days, all of my life here and everything you're talking about. one thing that we didn't build into our product when we started was administration controls. And we were selling to real estate brokerages and mortgages. Those are relatively small companies and they were, you know, screaming at us, telling us we need the configurations, rightfully so. You know, selling into huge organizations just want really granular. So if you're in the B2B space or any space, just constantly consider that. Going one step further kind of into the little, you know, technical approach on that, how do you pick the right database structure, tools, config, architecture when spinning something up? And kind of a twofold question, How do you think about refactoring code in products, or you know, how can you potentially reduce your technical debt up front by picking the right database structure, architecture, tools, et cetera?
Yeah, so I mean, I think an interesting thing has happened over the last, say, 10, 15 years, where it used to be that we all collectively wrote a lot of direct database queries and had a lot of direct interaction with the database. You know, kids these days coming up as programmers don't necessarily know anything about, you know, writing a SQL query, for example, because there's tools that have obfuscated that and made that unnecessary. But those tools are still doing the same thing under the hood. And so if we don't understand what Link is doing, what Active Record is doing, what, you know, whatever our library is doing, we can get ourselves into a corner where it worked when there were 10 records, but now that we have 100,000 records, it doesn't work anymore. And so one thing that we have learned to look at is just making it a part of the spec. What is the expected volume on this particular feature? Is this something that's expected to have, you know, is it a list of states and there's 50 of them and we know that? Or, you know, is this a list of something that could contain 50,000 records and then we need to handle that differently? That also kind of plays into your question about technical debt. You know, refactoring is sort of painful and unsexy and nobody really enjoys doing it. So if we know upfront what we're expecting for volume, then, you know, tools like Stack Overflow, you know, if it's an open source project, is it readily maintained? When was the last commit? You know, when was the last pull request? Can we tell that somebody is actively working on this? And what's the buzz around it? You know, are people saying they're having performance issues, or are people saying that this is going to work well for them? I think the second factor in that is your testing plan. You know, if you're going to refactor, you obviously have to test thoroughly. That sounds good, and everybody on paper agrees with that. But when it comes to actually doing it and having deadlines and pressure to ship, then sometimes that gets shortchanged. And so, you know, if we use a lot of automated end-to-end testing for that. And then, of course, you know, having your test scripts ready for your user testing as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Code coverage, testing, all that stuff is super important. It's the unspoken, I think, thorn in the side of a lot of engineers. they hate it and they love it. Yeah. It's important, yet it's frustrating. We talk about it all the time. And you know, I can't express personally how important it is, everyone needs to be thinking about it. Shifting gears a little bit away from the technical side slightly, back to the ops side a bit. When talking, you know, talking to customers is paramount, obviously. We're here to talk about changing the conversation, caring about conversation. It's what our product helps to do and what we believe in. So what are some standard procedures that you've seen successful for just messaging your customers? What are some of the more, you know, standard procedure and out of the box approaches that people have to talk to their customers?
Yeah, I think you have different categories of types of communication that you might need to have with a customer. And most people already inherently think about the sort of operational communication, alerting them when something happens in their account, you know, if they get a new lead, if they get a new order, whatever that is. We think that through and we're aware of that when we're planning the software. So we typically do that well. I would say in terms of a trend, it seems like people are moving away from wanting email notifications. You know, I think just general inbox overload has become a problem. And so people want control over that, whether it's turning those notifications that come in every time into a digest email that, you know, groups things together, or relying on more in-app notifications on that side. But another category that often gets neglected is communication about the product itself. And that can be positive communication. Hey, we've got a new feature, a new release we want you to know about. It can also be negative communication. Maybe the service is down, you're experiencing some difficulties and you want to communicate with people. Tricky thing about that is if your software is down, you can't use your software to communicate with people about why your software is down, right? So, you know, having some sort of backup plan that is not contained within your software for communicating with people, you know, Status Page is a great product, you can use that. Even, you know, that can be a benefit to having an external email service that you're using to communicate with customers, because you can still utilize that even when things aren't working right within your platform.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We just sent a mass email to our users talking about our logo change. That's the more fun, proactive approach, but still conversational, effective, something we need to do and something where we can effectively communicate and use technology. We use Intercom. I think a lot of people use Intercom. It's pretty successful and been great. kind of on the operational side too of issues, what is an effective way for triaging customer issues? You know, what does an effective system look like for triaging customer issues? How should we be thinking about, you know, being able to manage thousands and thousands of users taking thousands of activities and interactions on your app or product every single day, who probably don't want to tell you there's a bug, or at least they don't want to help you fix the bug. They'll tell you it's there, but not help you fix it. So how can you help them fix it?
Yeah, so anecdote, we have automated bug reporting, and then of course we also have methods for people to report a bug manually in person. And my guess is that less than 10% of bugs or issues that people encounter get reported by a human being. And if I think about my own life, even as a software developer, when I use other people's products, if I encounter an issue, the number of times I try to just move past it without reporting it versus the number of times I actually report it, I would say that probably holds true, right? Mm-hmm. So we can't rely on the users to be our eyewitnesses or be our single source of information about when things are going wrong, right? It's not their job. And so we use automated tools like Sentry to push that into a format where we can digest it. We have Sentry integrated with Slack, so we get notifications about it, and then we use the assignment tools within that. You know, another important factor in that is, how do you know whose issue it is and how do you know how important of an issue it is, right? Because there may be a volume of things that are not show-stopping issues that you need to drop everything and fix, yet you don't want to lose track of them either. You know, so having, and it'll vary based on your product, but you know, the key is to come up with some sort of rules of how do we know if we're going to tackle this right away or if this is going to go on the long-term issues list.
Yeah.
And then having a QA process for it as well. I mean, the last thing you want is to fix a bug and introduce another one. So,
right. Coming back to the testing.
Always back to the testing.
So some of the tools that we've used or considered using are FullStory, fullstory.io. They kind of track your entire life cycle as a user coming through and using your website or product, automated. We just use Trello for a lot of our product roadmap and ticket management too. We also use a more GitHub integrated product called ZenHub to manage our sprints, and that includes our QA triage, just rounding out some of what we use. One of the last questions that I think is always on my mind, and I think probably on the minds of quite a few of our audience today. I talked about this when, you know, we were prepping for this, but in terms of thinking of where your product is when you first build it, it's in for us, you know, we're pretty hardcore focused in real estate, mortgage and leasing. But we definitely see opportunities in some adjacent markets and are exploring that. And we built our product very real estate first to start, and just everything screamed real estate, which is great. Made our users feel like it was built for them. How can you balance building products that are specific to specific industries that make it feel like it's built for them while still expanding?
So I have yet to see a product that did not, probably within 30 days of launch, dramatically expand what they thought their market was. Right, because people see something cool and they go, "Oh, that we could use this over here. This would work for this. This would work for that." Right, and that's a great thing. It's more revenue. You want that. You know, that the thing that we found to be effective is making your marketing very tailored. So, if you want to go after real estate agents, great. If you want to go after, you know, people selling life insurance, great. Go after those people, but try to keep the product generic. You know, and there are cases where keeping the product generic causes confusion and you just don't have a choice. You've got to use the industry specific term. Otherwise, it's not going to make sense to people. And then that's, you know, some technical debt that has to be addressed later when you expand. But in situations where you can, having that product be built in such a way that it's not using a lot of industry specific jargon, while still focusing the marketing, if people have come into it with the lens that this is a real estate product, they're going to see it through that lens and interpret the product as focused on real estate, even if the jargon remains more open.
Yeah. It's something that we're seeing every day, and we love solving it. We love thinking through, again, caring about our messaging, caring about the conversation, caring about how our product differs for each of these audiences. And I love how succinctly you define that, and, you know, just putting it simply that your marketing should be specific and your product should be generic. I think that that's a really good approach to a lot of the value creation that goes into building a company. Sales has to be very specific when they pitch it, but the product itself is still going to be pretty generic when someone buys it and uses it. So I think that's a great place to wrap, a great place to end this lovely discussion. I love talking about this stuff because, again, it just talks about, it's just what we do every day. And it's the stuff that a lot of people don't talk about that actually goes into building an extremely valuable company. So I truly appreciate it, Aaron. Thank you so much for spending time with us today. Can't wait to pick this apart more, talk to you more, learn a little bit more about how you've successfully scaled so many technology and so many companies. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Up next, we have a very exciting panel, a sales assembly panel with four folks. The panel discussion is about building the bridge between sales and marketing. So that'll be coming your way here shortly, just about in 30 seconds or so. Stay tuned.